Comrades and friends of labor, the police have indicated to me that the earlier number of 15,000 has swollen to in excess of 20,000. This is a big park and the crowd tick, tick, tick. And we start yet. Because when we announce the election date, you might have a crowd even larger than this one. And I feel a little jealous. I want to see a crowd like this at Connery on the afternoon and all the evening of Independence Day, because we're going there like we went there the last time. I want to begin by thanking all the comrades who have been with us over the last 21 years of this great party. I pay tribute to the founders of the former St. Vincent and the Grenadines Labour Party, those who have gone to the great beyond, Robert Milton Cato and Hudson Dennis and Tuffy Woods from this constituency, and St. C. Dakin and Hobbs Huggins. All of them, I want to recall them, to remember them here tonight. I want to remember all those who have worked in the vineyard of labor and the founders of the Movement for National Unity, and all those who have worked together since October the 16th, 1994, when this great party was launched. And those who are listening at home, especially the elderly, I want to greet you on behalf of this magnificent movement called the Unity Labour Party. I want those who are in the hospital, who have their radios on, those who are working and those who are inmates at our psychiatric facility, I want those who may have access at the prisons and listening, access to radio, I want to say that this great party is for every man and woman, every boy and girl, every son and every daughter. Tonight is a night for rejoicing. You hear me? Tonight is for rejoicing. And I will speak a little later tonight about why we must rejoice and why joy and love are so important to our daily lives and in going forward. Friday, October the 16th is also a very special day in a personal way for me. 47 years ago on October the 16th, as a young man of 22 years of age, I was studying University of the West Indies in Jamaica. I had been elected as president of the Students' Union in May of 1968, beginning my term of office on August the 1st, 1968. I was about to enter my third and final year in my degree program in the Faculty of Social Sciences. And on October the 15th, 1968, the Jamaican government banned a lecturer who was from Guyana, but who lectured at the university, Dr. Walter Rodney. He had gone to a Black Writers Conference in Montreal, Canada. And on his return, on the afternoon of the 15th of October 1968, the Jamaican government banned him from return to Jamaica. I heard the news in the early evening, and I immediately mobilized the thousands of students. And on October the 16th, we marched into Kingston. It was the largest protest that Jamaica had ever seen since the 1938 anti-colonial uprising. We as the students were beaten and tear-gassed by the Jamaican police and military. I was the leader of that protest at the age of 22. In another man's country, and on that day, I grew up as a political activist, and I made a commitment, a personal commitment, that the way in which I saw the Jamaican government behave and trampling upon people's freedoms and rights, that I decided on that day that I will dedicate my life to the upliftment of the people of the Caribbean, and very specially St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and to further ennoble our Caribbean civilization. My journey over those 47 years has not been an easy one. I studied all over the world, and when the University of the West Indies hired me to lecture, first in Jamaica and then in Barbados, I returned here in 1979, in the month of July, to be part of the nationalist movement as we move towards independence in that year. And while I was here, the Barbadian government declared me an undesirable person and prevented me from returning to my job in Barbados. I had, at that time, a wife and a son, Camilo. I had them to feed. I was granted a visiting professorship at a university in New York City. And all these things which have happened to me have steeled me. I have been beaten on the anvil of experience and forged in the cauldron of struggle. So that what you see today is a product of my upbringing in Connery and in St. Vincent, in Tom, where I also lived when I was a student. And on the basis of my training and on my experience, I came with Sir Vincent and Louis Straker towards this great decision to form the Unity Labour Party. And through all these years of struggle, I have been steadfast in the interests of the people. I have always taken the view that although the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, you can't climb Suffren Mountain in a straight line. You have to take a little zig. You have to take a little zag. But while you're taking your zigzag, you always keep your eye on the goal as to where you're going in the interest of the people. And in all my years of political struggle, I have been faithful to the people, and I have not lied to them on any matter of public policy. I have always come with honesty and straightforwardness. If I promise you that I will do something, I will do it. Chance, what I promise, the practical circumstances do not admit to me doing it then, I will give you the reasons why I have to delay doing it, but you can put your pot on the fire that I will get to it and do it for the people of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. When I became leader of this party, in 1998 December, nearly 17 years ago, I promised this party that together we will win not only the next election, which we did in 2001, but that we will make the Unity Labour Party the natural party of governance of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And we are the natural party of governance since our founding. Because in 17 years since I became leader, and in 21 years since this party was founded, we are in government for 15 of those 21 years. And God's willing, with your help, we will be there for another 5 years, 4 in a row. And we have had monumental achievements. I want to say to you, when we were in opposition, do not forget that when Vincent Beach led us in the June 1998 elections and we won 7 of the 15 seats, but got 55% of the vote, that we took the view that this position was untenable and that sooner or later the NDP government will do something and cause the people to rebel. And rebel, the people did. And in the year 2000, You recall that the town was locked down and they had to negotiate to cut short their term in office by nearly 3 years and call elections by the end of March 2001. And since then, we have not looked back. And on the platform here are stalwarts from that period who served. We have Conrad Sayers. We have Rene Matisse. We have Snaggy. We have Sir Vincent. We have Sir Louis. We have Montgomery Daniel. And I have to remember Gerald Thompson and Dougie Slater. And we have to remember Michael Hamlet of blessed memory. We have to remember Mike Brown. We have to remember Clayton Bergen. We have to remember Glenn Beach. We have to remember Selman Walters. We have to remember very much our brother who came from the United States and ran with us in the Northern Grenadines and succeeded, my brother Belma. We remember all of those comrades tonight. And then the Rose of the Valley, a very special woman, a woman who is of the highest quality, and we are very grateful that Almighty God has given us a successor to her in the form of Sister Debbie. Where we are now, and to go forward. In the book of Isaiah, it is promised a metaphoric New Jerusalem. And this New Jerusalem doesn't happen by chance. For this metaphoric New Jerusalem, a land in which we do not have people going to bed without food, where we have adequate shelter for people, where their opportunities are taken and they develop their God-given talents, and we live in peace, and we live in harmony, and we live in love, we live caring for one another under the suzerainty of Almighty God, it is possible for us to do it, but we have to work together in love and in caring. I began by telling you that tonight we must rejoice. And I went to the book of Isaiah today in thinking about what I have to say tonight, because a leader must always take time out to sit and reflect as to what message he is delivering to the people whom he has the honor of leading. Leadership is not something which comes upon you by chance. Leadership is something bestowed upon you by the grace of God and with the support of the people directed by the grace of God. And therefore, it's a responsibility to clear the pathway. that when you are going about your business and you may not think about certain things, it is the business of the leadership to think about them, discuss them with you, and together we clear the pathway for further development for this metaphoric new Jerusalem. And after 21 years, we must rejoice. In Isaiah chapter 66, verses 10 to 14, it is written, "Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her. All you who love her, rejoice greatly with her. All you who mourn over her. For this is what the Lord says, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the wealth of nations like a flooding stream. You will nurse and be carried on her arm and dandled on her knees, as a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you, and you will be comforted over Jerusalem. When you see this, your heart will rejoice, and you will flourish like grass. The hand of the Lord will be made known to his servants." You know, this St. Vincent and the Grenadines, the land of the blessed, we together, with God's grace, can make it in New Jerusalem. We have laid the basis. The basis is what? People. We don't have a lot of natural resources. Our main resource is our people. And to get the maximum out of our people, you have to train their minds and their hands, and you have to have them get the understanding of life and living on production, and prepare the conditions that they could apply their heart to wisdom and act in faith, knowing that faith is not something abstract, that it is made complete with works, with deeds. Now when I say that we must rejoice, we have to rejoice first of all that this is a land of peace. It is true we have criminal activities, but we are a peaceful place. And over the years, despite difficulties here and there, we have developed respect for one another, and we must continue to respect one another. And joy, which is the heart and soul of what you talk about, rejoice. That's what it is. Every day in our daily struggles, every man and every woman tries to attain joy and abide in it with the totality of their being. And while the ULP speaks to you of joy and optimism and hope and faith, the NDP, what they want to create is a joyless community. You listen to Adam Eustace as leader. There is no joy in him for the future. What you get from the platform of the NDP is nothing but bile and cussing and pulling down. We are not to go there. What we are doing, we are educating our people. And we have done a magnificent job in that way. And we have more things to do. in that regard. And we are building roadways. We are addressing health. We are taking care of the elderly, the poor. We are building the international airport at Dog Isle, nearing completion. We built a jet airport in Kenawan. We have a lot. We have a lot to rejoice about. We have a lot to be rejoicing about. And joy involves at its core love. Love. Now I hear the NDP going about mocking love. They say, Ralph, say, love you. But what about Mabel, who needs four sheets of galvanized? Is that love? The point is this. We have given out thousands and thousands of sheets of galvanized. And Mabel will get from the ULP. But if you says come to power, Mabel will never get. Never have a chance of it. They tell you. They tell you that when you go about talking love, that is not the way to do things. Love is not a thing which you privatize in. You just want to privatize the electricity company. You can't privatize love like how you want to privatize the electricity company. Love, by its nature, is a public good. And all of us must reach out to hold one another hands in going forward together. As leader of this great party, I am not encouraging you to pull down. I am not encouraging you to be negative. When somebody says it can't be done, we say yes, it can be done. And we have been saying so before Obama said so. Now, today, we celebrate. I want to tell you some matters on which, for the young and for the old, just this week, what we must celebrate about. On Wednesday, at our cabinet, we approved for selection before the end of this year 65 young persons to enter the nursing program at the nursing school. You hear me? We are training more nurses now than we need, and that's why we're exporting them. And what we are doing with our nurses, we are the only country in the world where we give you a free nursing education and then turn around and pay you $1,000 a month to go to nursing school. That is something about which we must rejoice. In the old days, the most they did in a year, and some years they did none at all, was 20. That's why when we arrived in office, there was a nursing shortage. And we had to ask Fidel Castro to send 20 for us. Do you hear me? And then this week, Wednesday again, we approved at the cabinet 14 5-year national scholarships, 5 fully funded 3-year scholarships, and 12 bursaries where we pay the economic costs of $20,000 a year to the University of the West Indies, and we give the students a year $20,000. 21 in all. On Wednesday alone, it was the business of us to help approximately 100 young Vincentians, most of them from the poor and the working people, to advance in St. Paul. And then on Thursday, they sent for me a list of the persons in the recent A-level CAPE exams had passed two subjects and general and the communication studies. 198 of them. And then 547 who had passed five subjects including English and math. And those 745 persons, I approved the number to get before the end of this month or early next month, $500 a piece for their accomplishment. That is almost 850 people on Wednesday and Thursday, young people that we have taken care of. You hear me? And I gave instructions. In fact, I called Mr. Scott, who heads the community college. And I called the chief education officer. I said, I don't like how we only give the $500 to those who did CXCs and A-levels. What about those who do well at the B-plus level and above in the associate degree? I said, send me the names for those and I will find money too to give them the $500. I applaud you, Mr. That is, that's a number which will go past 1,000 young people. Rejoice, that is a birthday present from the Unity Labour Party. Because I have announced already that come January, I will be increasing the public assistance by $25 a month. Take it from those who are over 65 and over, to take them to $250. Those who are under 65, they will go from 200 to 225. I want to say to the elderly persons who are listening to me at home and some who are here, I want you to rejoice about things that this government has done for the old people in St. Vincent and Grenadines. And I will tell you this, I am the voice of the elderly. I am their advocate in St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and I want them to know that I love them, and I give them their love wholeheartedly. And when people want to say why I'm giving them an extra $25 next year, I say it will cost just over $1.5 million more a year. The book of Deuteronomy teaches me that divide him with an open hand and an open heart. The good Lord will bless me in everything that I do or I see. And when you do that, no weapon formed against I shall prosper. It is this government that instituted the home help for the elderly, costing about $1 million a year, with nearly 100 trained home helpers for the elderly, taking care of approximately 400 old people. The elderly must rejoice. And I say this, when we look and saw a number of families with their elderly parents and grandparents, we said, we will build 2 elderly centers, golden years activity centers. One down at Bukament and the other one at Black Point, to take care of old people, and we bought buses to transport them. And over the next 5 years, it is our intention to have one in East St. George and one in Miracle. Because more and more people are getting a living longer. And at the Lewis Burnett home, it can hold 110 persons. And there are more than 110 elderly persons who need help. And I prefer to see the old people being taken care of in their homes than to send them to the Lewis Burnett home, important as that home is. And it is we who are putting on toilets and rooms and so forth for the elderly who have a problem with their foot, who have a problem with their limbs, under the Lives to Live program. Gumbria already done 70 units, and he has another 3 or so doing in every single constituency over the next few weeks. You hear it? You hear what? You hear why we have to rejoice? And shortly, there would be a reason for rejoicing for persons who are suffering from foot ulcers. Because we have already sent the 200 and almost $250,000 to Cuba to get the Herbapap P medication to apply to some 50 persons. We have sent persons to train already so that they don't have to cut off the foot because they have an ulcer, to help take care of them. You hear? That is labor love, and that is a cause for rejoicing. And when we are finished with our guy and we decommissioned the E.T. Joshua Airport, we are putting a city there. And already the World Bank has provided the funding to select 8 acres of land there for an acute referral hospital while we are fixing up Milton Cato. We are going to put, in addition to the 4 theaters at Milton Cato, we're going to put an extra 1. And we are specializing down in certain things, including pediatrics and obstetrics and gynecology for the women. And we are having the acute referral hospital out at Argyle, at Arnesville. And we are going to have 6, a hospital with 6 theaters there, Try 6 and 5, 11 and 1 we are putting at the medical complex in Georgetown, making 12 theaters. I have signed a memorandum of understanding with an entrepreneur from Trinidad who's involved in business in Trinidad, a big man in Trinidad, for a shopping, entertainment, cinema complex, and with a small boutique hotel right out there at Arnesville. I want to show you something tonight which I haven't shown in public yet. In my hand here, is a document called St. Vincent and the Grenadines Port Authority, Port Rationalization and Development Study, Arnesville Site, Phase 1 Extension. And what we are going to do with the port, we have done a study already by these people called Mark McDonald, the Caribbean Development Bank, lent us the money to move the Port Kingston down towards the bottom town area. Because the port is 60 years old, it's falling apart. And the one they built 20 something years ago at Camden Park, they didn't build it properly. And it's not up to the task for a modern, sophisticated society like ours. So just like how I had to build a jet airport in Canawan and an international airport at Argyle, and I will talk about that shortly, I have to build a new port. And the cruise ship here, who is not even 20 years old, the cruise ship here is inadequate. And we were thinking first that we will extend it. But the experts said, instead of extending it, we are suggesting that you put it at Arnesville, where you're building the city. And I want to show you the picture. This is a conceptual design.
Getting it?
With the cruise ship berth here, when the plane normally come over to land, and right inside of the harbor itself, we will do some dredging and put in a marina there with 50 berths. So we'll have a marina there. When you have a marina and you have 50 berths, which can take 50 cruise ships, 50, sorry, yachts, and they have 5 or 6 persons to every yacht, what you have there is a floating hotel with 250 to 300 rooms. And they will come in on the plane at Argyle and they will take the yacht from there and sail down in the Grenadines. You see why I tell you, if we walk together, we can get to a metaphoric Jerusalem. Not tomorrow, not next week, not in 5 years, but we are on a journey building on what we have accomplished, building on what we have accomplished thus far. Because in 2005, this was our manifesto. This was our plan. This is our manifesto of 2010. And I am telling you that 2015 manifesto is already drafted based on the 2013 to 2025 National Social and Economic Development Plan, which is already on the website since October 2013. You want plan? Ask out. Leadership is not something you can go to a supermarket and buy it off the shelves as though it is cornflakes. The people of this country on three occasions have said that they do not want Arnim Eustace to lead them. Once, when he was Prime Minister, when he got it as hand-me-down from James Mitchell, and twice when he tried to get it from me, I beat him three times, and I will give him a fourth put backside. And then, the geothermal project we have in the earth in St. Vincent, depending on which estimates you take, between 150 and 300 megawatts of power steam coming up. There is a geothermal source of 60 megawatts, which is three times approximately our current peak demand is 21 megawatts. And the source which we're exploiting on the windward side of the Sofri Mountain, by the end of 2018, we will be having a 12 megawatt plant there. We'll be saving $35 million in fuel coming in. And you will get your electricity between 15 to 25% cheaper. And so to the business, part and parcel of developing St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And I have serious people involved, Imera and Reykjavik Geothermal. And the individual who helped us to put them together is President Bill Clinton. And Camilo had worked on it when he was at the United Nations. You hear me? Anybody inside of the NDP got them kind of contacts to be doing things to get these sort of movements? The NDP opposed the geothermal bill in the House. And then we have signed a memorandum of understanding with Canadian investors to develop Mount Green Peter's Hope. You heard Sir Louis talk about it. They would not have been coming if you didn't have the Argyle International Airport nearing completion. I hear them make all kind of talk about the airport. That Ralph want to wait until you open the airport to call election. They really don't understand me. I don't play politics with serious projects enough. I have told the people of this country that though by the end of this year, the Argyle International Airport ought to be operational, I am not going to own it until I have every I dotted and every T crossed and the plane them ready to land down and bring man and woman from Paris. I see a journalist writing, taunting me about opening that or not opening. I hear people at the NDP taunting me. A warrior like me, them kind of jokers, they could taunt I? hindi bigla mag-joke, ha? Top positions to run the airport company. You hear me? We are already, and we have given the sanction of cabinet to the persons to be employed for the top positions, because we have set up a committee to do it. You saw them in the newspapers. I heard the fellow Friday say that is only a gimmick. I don't know if Friday ever run anything inside of his life. But one thing I want to say, Friday, I saw something in a newspaper article which the fellow Anatole Scott wrote. He went and spoke to Friday and said, Friday, why are you not taking a more serious position in leadership inside of the NDP? He said that he ain't doing it because inside of the NDP, they don't like his red skin. You ever hear anything like that? You never know that Friday is a white man. You never know that Friday come from pirate. He said two reasons, that is one, because I red skin. And the second one, the guy from the Grenadines. But how come a redskin man from the Grenadines was prime minister of this country for 16 and a half years? Friday, the reason why you can't go for leadership, you have no leadership qualities. If you want to take leadership lessons, go to St. Mitchell or come to the Comrade. And then, we are dealing with the matter of, we talked about the hospitals. You may remember in 2007, when we said to the Kingston Medical School that because you don't want to come to proper terms and conditions, if you want to go, go. They said, yes, they will go. Eustace joined the chorus and started to say that it is because I have relations with Fidel and Chavez that the Americans tell the medical school to move out. It's what kind of rubbish. You know, the worst thing about mental slavery is this. It's not so much that the individual has you in mental slavery, but that you yourself put limits on your thinking to such an extent that you impose mental slavery on yourself. And that's why Brother Mark Marley say, is none but ourselves can free ourselves. You hear me? Now, I told the people who are leasing their properties then, I say you will have a slightly difficult period. But we will get more medical schools. And now we get four. With 1,000 students and rising. Four times the students which used to be here. And people renting properties from Camden Park, go right out to Stubbs, and every place in between. And with these hospital facilities which we are renovating, expanding, putting polyclinic in Bucamend and one in Mesbo, and we have one in Stubbs already. What we are doing there is to provide the facilities to get more medical students to come to spend more money in St. Vincent and the Grenadines to help lift the economy. And meanwhile, investors are lining up for further hotel development here in St. Vincent, in Beckway, and in Union Island. And in Kanawan, the expansion has resumed and continuing apace. And by June next year, the marina in the south of Kanawan, with 130 berths, top of the line, in which the government has shares, because we're putting our land as equity, that you're going to have fantastic development there. And there's a hotel which has been built in the developed area called Pink Sands. There's none like that anywhere in the Caribbean, and that will be opening in Easter. There is much harvest to come and much rejoicing in St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And Saboto has his agricultural development plan with a series of commodities to be grown, and we are supporting them, and small ruminants like sheep and goat and pigs, we're developing also that industry further, and cattle. All these things are happening at the same time, and we are trying to keep bananas steady, as supposed to explain on more than one occasion. And the development of the fishing industry continues. And we will continue to provide the $6 million a year, which we did last year and this year, to lend to the farmers at 2%. We get that money from Petrocaribe. And you said, say, must unsigned Petrocaribe. He's a madman. You know, I see 11 o'clock, and you have been here for a long time. I want to hail up the 57,000 viewers who are viewing what we are doing here online. You hear me? That is at 8:08. The report has come to me that 57,000 persons are following the comrade speech online, in addition to the 20,000 here. You hear me? And meanwhile, that is happening. The NDP got a meeting by Huffles with 140 people. Yeah? They are quaking in their boots. Say to you, we are going to have an opening, a reopening of Jomo's office. You know, it was burnt. I am not saying who burned. I would leave Jomo to deal with nature. You hear me? You can't put nature in the same boxing ring like me. It could be advantage. Today, the police had returned the property 2 days ago. We will hear the results of the investigation. I'm advised that the place was cleaned up today, and the rebuilding will start tomorrow. And labor intends to complete that rebuilding by Friday. By Friday. And then when we announce when we're going to have a session there, You have to come out in your numbers to support Jomo, who's a good man. I will tell you this, believe me when I tell you, and I have the facts. The NDP is trailing the ULP in every single seat on St. Vincent. In all 13, they're trailing us. And I want to tell you that in all 13, in the prime ministerial stakes, I'm beating Eustace bigger than ever, even in his own constituency. This is going to be a washout. I am saying this to you. Arnim Eustace cannot help one single MDP candidate. He has no coattails. In fact, the candidates all about, they're happy if they don't see Arnim.
Captain out, and man out.
They're happy if they don't see him. Because rather than lifting them up, you pull them down. You hear me? You will see when they have public meetings, I will dare Arnim Eustace to speak at the end. Look, the leader of the ULP is speaking at the end, and the people remain. If you have an NDP meeting, they chuck in Eustace in the first one third or by the middle, because they're afraid that if they wait till the end, everybody got away and you will be talking to an empty place. So I'm saying to the NDP, you have a leader, do not hide him.
If you don't have, you gotta bring Eustace. Let's go on the engine, yes.
I'm saying Arnim, they cannot hide you. I will not allow them to hide you. Have some self-respect and talk last. Anchor the meeting like how the comrades anchor it. If you name man, if you name man, anchor it. And you will see what happens. To tell you the truth, they are already panicking so much that Lika, for instance, realized that the ULP and Beresford and the comrade that we are doing very well in Central Kingston. He started whole a set of little meetings here and there with some fellas from the village talking. He panicking. And we ain't start yet. We ain't put on the pressure yet. Wait till they hear about this 20,000. I ain't called the election date yet. And I ain't calling it tonight either. I told the whole country that I will not be found loitering on democratic premises at the closing time. Make sense out of that. I also said that whenever I announce the election date, I am going to give them a short period of time. A short period of time Because as a farmer boy, I know, and all men know, that it ain't long rope does hang cattle, it's short rope. And I given them a short rope. Short rope. And they're going to get licks like peas. Well, I have given you the reasons tonight why you must come with us for a photo. We have a compelling developmental narrative, a people-centered vision with policies and programs for the people. We have achievements monumental in every area of public policy. And for the investments which are coming and the infrastructure development to lay the basis combined with the education, there will be jobs galore. And the roads, as you notice, they start to pave at they start to pave the road which they're doing here in South Leeward. And we have not broken our promises. We have had good governance. We have been open with the people. We have quality candidates and quality leadership. And above all, we have an abiding love and faith in the people of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. I know that some people had strayed in 2010 and some stayed home. But I see that they have come back to labor. And we are going to make history in the Caribbean by winning bigger in a fourth term than we won in our first term.
Control. Election Day. Canada, in Miami, and I send greetings to the teachers and the civil servants, and the nurses and the police. We love you. We love you very much. I want to thank you for coming out in your large numbers. This is magnificent. We can rely on labor to celebrate magnificently. God bless you. And keep working. Make sure your name is on the list. Be sure as we get a new ID card. Take care of Granny and Papi. Love them. And the morning of election, work with our organization to get them to the polls early. Come on here, take care, Granny. Good night, and may Almighty God continue to bless you and have a safe trip home. Be careful.